219. 219. I'm winging my way back home. Y'all did good on that. I'll make sure I tell Gina that.
Oh, Praise the Lord for the good choir singing. Good to see everybody tonight. Man, what a great service we had this morning. Man, the church was full, had one saved, had people on the altars, baptized too. Praise the Lord for what God's doing. Amen. But I'm excited about what God's going to do tonight. Tonight is one of those nights that I've not had any peace all week about what to preach, and I'll go ahead and say that in order so that you can be praying. I desire your prayers. I'm going to ask that you continue to pray all throughout the service. Got a couple of announcements to make, and then we'll take up the offering. Sandra Mueller, who always attended here, she had begun going to South Calhoun Baptist Church, passed away. Sandra passed away night before last. Sandra had started going to South Calhoun, with Bobby Dodd. They were here for revival just a few nights ago. I believe they was here Tuesday night. And she had gone home, and Bobby went to take her to, Bobby had gone to pick her up yesterday morning and found her. She had died sometime during the night. Her memorial service will be Tuesday at 11 a.m. at Thomas Funeral Home. I'll be doing the service. Visitation will be from 10 to 11 at Thomas, and then the service will be at 11 a.m. Y'all remember to pray for Bobby. Bobby's gone to Israel with us two times. He may be a deacon out at South Calhoun, but he's certainly part of our family. We love Bobby, and Bobby's heart broke, so y'all remember to pray for him. Also, remember to pray for Janie Grogan. Talked to LC after service this morning, and Janie has had another small stroke. They're calling it small. They don't see a lot of damage, but she still is in the hospital down at Piedmont. And LC seems to think that she may get out tomorrow. If she doesn't, I'll be going down there to see them tomorrow afternoon, and I'll keep everybody updated. But remember those two families and all the rest of the ones that we have on our prayer list. We've got so many, and it's so important that we pray for these people collectively. And people come to us all the time asking for our prayers, and I take that as a serious responsibility. So I ask that you all pick up one of our prayer requests outside and remember these families. And I'm going to ask at this time, if some ushers will come forward, we're going to take up an offering tonight. I'm going to ask Brother Dudley if he'll say a prayer tonight.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for bringing us back to your house tonight. Lord, Father, we thank you for the service this morning. And once again, Lord, we thank you for that precious soul that was saved. Father, we pray there might be more tonight. Lord, we know it's a Sunday night service, but Father, there might be somebody come in this building tonight lost and undone, seeking you, Lord. We know they will find you right here. Lord, bless our pastor and anoint him, and give him what he stands in need of tonight, Lord, especially tonight, Lord. Father, we ask that you bless this offering. Father, bless those that have to give, those that have not. And Father, we pray we do especially as you'd have us do with this money, Lord, so that we might go out in this world, Lord, and somebody might be saved because of it, Lord. We love you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
voice of love that's calling. And there's a chair that awaits for you. And a friend who understands everything you're going through. Standing at a distance in the shadow of your shame, and there's a light of hope that shines. Won't you come and take your place and bring it all to the table?
Thank you, Taya and Bryson. That was, I asked them to do that kind of last minute. So thank y'all for that. Turn in your Bibles to the book of Psalms. We're going to look at the 18th Psalm, I think. One thing while you're flipping there, remember Lori Fordham. Lori's had a little bit of a setback today. She's still at home, but she has had to increase some medication, and she's requiring some more oxygen to breathe. Lori has been battling cancer now for quite a while, and she was going to come to church this morning but wasn't able to, and that's why. So remember Lori when you pray. All right, Psalm 18. I'm going to read the first three verses. David says, I will love thee, O Lord, my strength. The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer, my God, my strength, in whom I will trust, my buckler, and the horn of my salvation, and my high tower. I will call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from mine enemies. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. Lord God, I just want to do what you'd have me to do tonight, Father. God, just I want to be obedient. I pray, God, that I would not say anything that's not of you. I would not do anything that's not of you, Lord. Father, I pray, God, that you would just lead God and direct us. I thank you for the prayers of your people. God, I thank you for what's already been done here, God. I can't thank you enough for the soul that was saved this morning, those who followed through in believers' baptism. Father, for everything that was done at these altars, Lord, it was such a sight to see these altars full, God, with people in submission to you, Lord, Father. But God, you know my heart tonight, Father, and I pray, God, that I not get in the way. I pray there's one here tonight that's never come to know you, that today will be the day of thy salvation. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. All right. I had planned all week to preach out of the book of Romans tonight. Bryson had came in from, I believe, the Fountains this afternoon, and he asked me what I was doing, and that was around, I guess, about, I don't know what, 4 o'clock, Bryson, something along those lines. Told him I had no idea, but I had been led, and my heart had been reading this particular psalm over the last couple of days. I did not anticipate preaching on this because it's the words that I was drawn to in this particular passage. This morning, we preached about what do you see when you look at the cross? What do you see when you look at the cross? Well, tonight, I want to talk for just a few minutes about what God means to you. Because I've been thinking about that all afternoon. I've been thinking about what he means to me. David goes into very detail here in just a few minutes in the scriptures that we've already read about what he meant to him and what he had brought him through. Well, that just jogs my memory of what God's brought us through, what God's brought me through, and no doubt what God has brought you through. I don't forget, and I always remember of who I used to be, of where I was in life years ago, and I hope that you do too. Now, we don't stay there, but once we were born again, we began to walk with the Lord. That did not mean that everything became unicorns and rainbows. It just got more difficult at times. You see, at that point when you're born again, you get a target on your back. You see, those who are lost are no threat to the devil. But those who are saved and those who desire to do the work of the Lord, those who desire to live for Him, when you've got a church that desires to see souls saved, then you become a target. I said this morning that this is not my church. This is not any one person's church. This is God's church, and God's church, it will remain. But as I look at the scriptures this evening, I remember just what God means to me. Now, David spoke these particular words that I've read in this psalm in the day that the Lord delivered him from the hand of his enemies and the hands of Saul. And he said these words. There's no outline here. We're just going to look at these words and look at what they meant to David. Verse 1, he says, I will love thee, O Lord. David loved God for a few reasons. If you read, you can read in 2 Samuel 22. It's about 51 verses, and it'll take you back, and you'll understand a little bit more about this. But David loved God for a few reasons, not only because he had delivered him at this particular time, not only that he had rescued him from his trial, but also for another reason. The other reason is, but what God had taught him through the trial. What God had made him into through this trial, and he loved him for it. Oftentimes, we read the words of David, have you forgotten me? Those are not far-fetched. How often have you been in a trial and all you wanted was to be out of it? All you wanted was the road to come to an end because you believed that you had learned enough. But God knows better. God knows what He's doing with each and every one of our lives. Whatever storm that you may be in, and I've preached this before, some of you desire to get out of the trial, but the problem is you're in a storm of correction, the Jonah storm. Jonah was in his storm because of disobedience. The apostles that were on the boat in that storm was a storm of perfection. So it's not all the time that sin brings you to a trial. But it's also not all the time that it doesn't, that you can live a life and you're in the will of God, that you don't need to think that just because you're living that way that you're not going to have trials. So what one of the things that, or one of the reasons that David loves the Lord is because what he learned during that trial. You know, I love God's timing. And it's easy to say that when you've just come out of a trial. It's very difficult to enjoy God's timing when you're in such a trial because everything's going hard. But see, I know that there's been trials in my life that God has strengthened me in that trial. And I come out of that trial and I'm able to look back and I am madly in love with the Lord because what he taught me along the way. He never left me. He's not forsaken you. He's not going anywhere. He's with you every step of the way. No matter what you're going through, no matter what you may go through, he is there. David was in love with God, not only because he delivered him, not only because he rescued him, but what he taught him through this trial. It's important to understand that tonight. David was not bitter against God. Once he had delivered him, we don't read in these scriptures, we don't read in these words that David said, "It's about time, God, that you delivered me." We don't see that. He was grateful. He was grateful for the years of trials because God had done something necessary in his life. See, here's the thing, church. Right now, in the midst of whatever trial that you may be in, God's doing something necessary to grow you. And here's why. Because we would never do it on our own. Sometimes it takes God lighting the fire to us in order for us to truly grow, how God wants us to grow, to learn what God wants us to learn. Oftentimes, he does these things and he puts us in situations where he's the only one that we can call on. And I know it's scary at times, but after the trial, that's a great place to be. There's people in here tonight probably feel lonely. You probably feel like nobody knows what you're dealing with right now. God knows what you're dealing with, and he knows where you are. Don't you ever think he's forgotten you? Don't you ever think that he's abandoned you, child of God? He knows exactly where you are. David thanked him for that. He was grateful. We see in verse 1 that through all of this, David says, God was his strength. His strength. Can you imagine reading, we don't have time tonight, about everything that David went through. Can you imagine him making it without him? Well, I just look at my little old life, and I can't imagine making it without God. He has been my strength. He has been your strength, and that's what David is thanking him for. That's one of the reasons that he tells him that he loves him is because he was his strength. I can't imagine going through some of the things that I've seen some of you overcome in this very church, your day-to-day life, without God. Some of you, over the last couple of years, has lost your spouses. Some of you have lost your children. Some of you have lost your parents. I've seen you go through this. I've seen horrible times come upon the people, God's people, just here at Heritage Baptist Church. But I have stood back and we have prayed for you and I have watched you make it through only by the strength of God. So listen to me, beloved. Whatever that you're in today, you're going to make it because it's that same strength that brought you through before. It's the same strength from the same God that's going to take you through it again this time. He's not left you. He's not forsaken you. David knew that God was his true source of strength. The Lord, in verse 2, is where it gets good. These words, man, they just jump off the page of God's word to me. And as I began to read them, I thought, yes, you are all these things to me. David says, he says in verse 2, he says, the Lord is my rock. The Lord is my fortress. He says, the Lord is my deliverer. See, David used military terms there because that's who he was. Listen to me. When God saved you, he knew who you were. He called you to be who you are now. Don't you try to be nobody else. If you're called to preach, don't you try to preach like nobody else. If you're called to teach, don't you try to teach like nobody else. Don't you try to do anything that anybody else does. God's called you for a specific reason. David uses those terms. He says that he is his rock. Man, I love that phrase. But let's look at the definition. See, in the Bible, that particular phrase there, the rock, It means this. It means a place of shelter. It means a place of safety and security. Church, we need that more today than we ever have. You know, we always encourage people about staying in the house of God. This morning, there's over 500 people here. There's not that tonight. I worry about those people. And I know things come up, but listen to me. And I'm not saying that 345 Curtis Parkway is the only rock where God can give you shelter, but I know this. I know that it's an awful scary place out there when you're away from God and His people. God says, David says, you are my rock. We need that today. So many of God's children, they're at a church, they've gotten away from God, and they're just bumping around out in a lost and dying world. The devil himself, roaming about seeking whom he may devour. But see, David said, he said, you are my rock. Does that make sense to anybody in here tonight? Is it, do you understand? Is he your rock? Is he your rock that gives you safety and security? Next, look what David says. He says, God, you are my fortress. It's a place of strength. It's also a place of safety. Not only can you hide in the Lord, in the rock, but you can also be safe in the Lord. David goes on and he says, God, you are my deliverer. Deliverer. See, God made a way for David to escape. See, that's the thing. God always makes us a way. God made a way for the escape. David wanted out, but God was the way. So many times we are in God's will, and because we are in some type of trial, we look for other avenues out of the trial. We look for other ways to get out, but true deliverance only comes from God. God had delivered David at this particular point. We read in the Old Testament, God delivered the children of Israel. He delivered us, as we stand here tonight, from our sins through Jesus Christ. Many of us tonight need delivered. We need a way of escape. Jesus is the way. We heard it all last week in revival, John 14:6. I am the way, I am the truth, I am life. No man comes to the Father but by Jesus Christ. See, that's what David knew. David said, I love you, God. You are my rock. I was safe in you. You are my fortress. I was secure in you. And you are my deliverer. You took me and gave me a way out. Many of us in here tonight, we need a way out. We're stuck in our sins. We're all up to our ears in sin, and our lives are falling apart, and we're looking for other ways out. God can deliver you tonight, yes, on a Sunday night. On just a Sunday night service. See, that's the thing. People don't think that, well, I ain't got to come back for Sunday night. I've give God my hour. I was there this morning, preacher. That's enough. That's enough. What else do you expect? I gave $12. I was there this morning service. And they think that's enough. Yet this whole entire time, they need delivered. They're going to the jobs tomorrow. And they're just going to be wrapped about by sin. They're going to be sucked in by the wiles of the devil. And they're looking for other ways to be delivered. David said, you, God, only you are my deliverer. He has delivered me. Many of us tonight, we need delivered. He says there on in the scriptures, he says, whom I will trust. David knew that God was really all he had. Church, can I tell you something? God is really all any of us have. I love my wife. She's sitting right here with all my heart. I've got two precious children that I love with all my heart. But I'm a man, and I'm susceptible to letting them down. I will do that. Your flesh, you will let people down. You've got to put your trust not in me, not in your pastor, not in your preacher, not in your Sunday school teacher, not in your deacon. David knew where his trust needed to be, and that was in God and God alone. I'll just stand here tonight and I'll tell you, I'll never let you down on purpose. I never hurt you on purpose. But don't ever forget, we're all still in the flesh. So understand that tonight. Our trust needs to be in God. David knew God was all that he had, but he was all he really needed. See, that's all we really need. Now, I'm not telling you to certainly not to turn your back on your family. That's not what I'm saying. But I'm saying there's times when your spouse is not going to know what to say. There's times that your parents or your brother or your sister or even your children cannot comfort you like God can through the Holy Spirit. You've got to understand David knew who he could trust. Sometimes, as difficult as places that we are in, that's God's will. Sometimes we get in places and we ask, God, why in the world am I here? Because God wants you to trust Him and Him alone. And we find ourselves in places like that. For some, it's been jail. For some, it's been hospitals. For some, it's been depression. For some, it's been loneliness. We read all throughout the Scripture, Jonah, Jeremiah, Elisha, Elijah. They all suffered loneliness at times. But the reason so that they would 100% truly, wholeheartedly rely on God and God alone. See, God's a jealous God, and He's got every right to be. We are in a world and a culture today that is slap full of idolatry. But what we do and what we see is, well, I've got no golden calves. I've got no wooden rams. I don't know. Idolatry is a has-been word, Pastor. No, but here's the thing. It's just evolved. Listen, it is safe to say that nearly 99% probably, and those are not educated statistics. That's Shane, not Bible. Let me step here. It's Shane statistics. Cell phones. Social media, entertainment, it's our idol. If we were to go around, and I've said this before, so don't turn me off because you never like it when I say it. If we were to go around the room and there's a place on your phone to where you can look at your screen time, y'all know what's coming, and you looked at your daily screen time, how would it compare to your daily Bible time? Well, Pastor, I've got the Bible app on my phone. Well, we can look at that too. How would it compare? Are you telling me that there's no such thing as idolatry? We've got, before I ever left law enforcement, we would respond to homes to where parents would take kids' phones and the kids would become violent. Now, I don't know what's worse about that. If kids become violent with daddy, or that daddy has to call 911, because I can assure you, when I was a kid, it would have been a call to the ambulance, not the cops. I can assure you that. So I don't know what's worse. But see, there is idolatry. Have you spent more time today on Facebook looking at, listen, a bunch of sad people looking awful happy, and you've compared yourself, you've compared your family, look at their house. Look at what they've got. And you all know that they're just like me and my family. There's only one place in my house we can take a picture that's clean. They're the same way. They're all the same way. Y'all have got those corners too. Risa tells, don't take a picture there. You'll get the dogs in it or something. So we have to go to a corner over here. And it looks clean. I'm just kidding, babe. No, I'm not kidding. I'm your pastor. I can't lie. Look, we live in our house. I'm in love with my wife. I love my kids. I got two dogs that are just like other kids. Look, we live in it. How did I get here? Where was I at? No, but listen, that's the deal. You've got social media, and we are trying to live a life. We're trying to live a life that is false, to live a life that's fake. And we're comparing ourselves, and we spend so much time doing those things. It becomes our idol. We've got a desire to be seen a certain way on social media. Well, who are we fooling? What do we think? Listen, yeah, and y'all don't want to preach on those filters again. What are we doing? I know y'all don't look like cartoons. I see y'all every week. What are we doing? But it's idolatry. And we're chasing idols. We're out here and we chase those, but yet we tell ourselves that, look, we don't have idols, Pastor. We don't have those things. We put our trust in all sorts of things, when just like David, we should put our trust in Him. That's the only place it's going to stand, is when our trust is in Him. Here's the next one. Look at what he says. We're still in verse 2. Verse 2, he says, the Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer, my God, my strength, in whom I will trust. Look at this next word. He is my God. David says, God, you are my buckler. Buckler. Buckler means shield, is what that means. It was a shield that affixed to your forearm. And it would defend against the head, and it would defend against the heart. It defended the essentials. See, that's what he said. He says, you are my buckler. It covered the essentials. God protects the main things. See, David, he went through some trials. He went through some hard times. He had some injuries. But the essentials were protected by God. He protected his mind. He protected his heart. Listen, you may stump your toe, but don't forget, God's protecting what matters. He says, you're my buckler. See, that's the difference. Let's look at that here. We've talked about the rock. David said, you're my rock when we started tonight. He said, you are my fortress, but now he says, you are my buckler. What's the difference? See, the rock and the fortress are when we're hunkered down. And there's a time for that. There's a time to be still, know that I'm the Lord. There's a time that we need. God calls us to hunker down. God calls us to take our families and hunker down in prayer. To hunker down. But see, the buckler is for something different. The buckler, the shield, is for when we go out and do the work of God. Mark 16:15, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Listen. David said, because if you read about David, there was a time when he hunkered down. There was a time when he got in the caves. There was a time that he hid. But there was also times that he went. And that was what the shield was for. That was when he had to go. He had to take that buckler. We read about it on in Ephesians chapter 6, the full armor of God. See, we got to go. Yes, God is your rock. You can hide in Him. He's your fortress. He'll protect you. But listen to me, child of God. We're not expected to stay hunkered down the whole time. We got to go. Listen, God called us to be separated, not isolated. We've got to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's what you're called to do in here. Yes, there are times of rest when you can hunker down, but not all the time. Some of us, we get hunkered down and we get this sense of safety and we never want to leave. We have to go. David says, when those times came, you have been my buckler. And then David says, still in verse 2, we're still in verse 2. Look in your Bible. It says, you are the horn of my salvation. You are the horn of my salvation. Now, horn there, in that particular scripture, it means, it's a Hebrew word that is kareen or caress. Caress or kareen. And what that means there is, it means strength. Means defense. It means to hold. It also, it can go on to mean in a flask, like something that you can put it in. But in this term, it means strength and defense. David knew that God keeps him. God keeps that salvation. God defends that salvation. David knew throughout all this, God was keeping him, and God was all he needed. Do you understand what David's saying there? You are the horn of my salvation. David didn't say, I'll keep my salvation. David said, you are the horn of my salvation. And then this is one of my favorites. He says, you, we're still in verse 2. He says, you, God, He is a high tower. A high tower. What that word means there, it means a stronghold. He says, God, you are my stronghold. You are my tower of refuge. See, with the Lord being David's high tower, it meant that he could see many enemies from great distances, and he was protected by the adversary. See, the Holy Spirit does that for us now. The Holy Spirit can see distances. He lets us know when there is trouble on the horizon. In church, there's trouble on the horizon. I believe that if you spend any time in prayer, you spend any time with the Lord, and you truly get along with Him, I believe that Holy Spirit now being our high tower, there is truly trouble on the horizon. Look at this world that we're living in. Our main purpose, let me tell you, some of you I've talked to and you've said this, I don't know what God's called me to do. Well, I'm going to tell each and every one of you tonight what God has called you to do. Number one is the greatest commandment, to love the Lord thy God with all your heart, soul, and mind, to love others like yourselves. If you've accomplished that, your sole purpose is to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's why. Church, listen to me. Right now, there's been multiple cars pass this road out here of people who will never see, people who will never wake up tomorrow. Behind us is the interstate. How many cars? We couldn't even count. How many of these cars? There's been cars that have passed us, behind us, that will never reach their destination. They'll be in an accident. They'll be killed. They'll never meet where they're going. They'll never get there. There's people, you say, well, this is a little far-fetched. Well, I said this just week before last. We're talking about Miss Sandra Mueller. She was in our revival services this last week, and now she is with the Lord. She professed Jesus Christ as her Lord and Savior. But what if she didn't? What if it's you? What if it's you? Listen to me. You're called to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's what you're called to do. Each and every one of us. That is your calling. Trouble is on the horizon. I believe that we're in a time like we've never seen. I believe we're headed to a destination. I understand. I'm talking about in our lifetime. I understand Nero. I understand the persecution and the Roman candles and the beheadings that the early church dealt with. I understand that. That's not occurring in our church here. But just because it's not occurring in America does not mean that it's not occurring all throughout the world. See, we've got this mindset, this little mindset that it's all about America. That the church of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, only encompasses the United States of America. And that's the farthest thing from the truth. There are people dying every single day in order to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. We see that. We see what the adversary is doing to our brothers and sisters. God being our high tower. He keeps us. We identify the adversary. The adversary is the devil. But we've got family out there. As we sit back and we utilize God's high tower. He is our high tower. And as we look out, we see our families being picked off every single day by the devil. We have a culture of parents who has pretty much turned their children over to the devil. They didn't want to have to raise them, so they gave them technology. They didn't want to have to spend time. We can just give them a tablet. And I'm not saying that my kids never had a tablet. That's not what I'm saying. But I'm saying is nowadays, we don't even care. We just give it to them. He's picking them off. Listen to me, church. We have the same high tower that David had. We had the same deliverer that David had. So much of the church today has just dropped their heads. We're defeated. There's nothing we can do. Have you not seen the news, Pastor? Have you seen what's all going on? Jesus will be back any minute. Praise God if He does, but what if He don't? What if He tarries us coming another 1,000 years? And we've sat back. Reminds me of the church at Thessalonica when Paul went, preached to them, and they just sat down and quit. Is that what the church of the living God today has done? David knew who he trusted in. We say who we trust in. Have we quit? Verse 3 says, I will call upon the Lord who is worthy to be praised. so shall I be saved from mine enemies. Now, in context, that occurred. God saved David from his enemies. He saved him from all those who were after him. He saved him from the hands of Saul. And David was glorifying him, which is rightfully so. He needed to be. But I want to ask you a question. Do you still believe that he is worthy to be praised? Is he worthy for you to live like he... Now listen. Listen to me. If he's worthy to be praised, then he's worthy for us to live for him. We're ambassadors of Jesus Christ. Are you living for him? Because it's easy for the Christian to say, yes, praise the Lord. He is worthy to be praised. We want to praise him. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. Worthy, worthy, worthy. It's lip service. It's lip service. In a day to where there is absolutely no difference, statistically speaking, in divorces in the lost and dying world, in divorces in the church, it's estimated that over 70% of pastors are addicted to pornography. It's lip service. It's estimated that sexual harassment occurs in the church. It's estimated and even been proved that all across the church today, that the same sins that are without are the same sins that are within. Now listen to me. The devil did not burst in and kick the door down and make any of us do that. We brought the devil with us. See, we don't truly believe that he's worthy to be praised. We want deliverance from our enemies, yet we go to bed with our enemies. We want deliverance with our enemies, yet we buddy up to our enemies. Our enemy is the adversary. Our enemy is the devil, and he is seeking to devour you. David knew what he came from. David knew what God had brought him from. He knew that where he needed to find his safety, he knew that he needed to get in the crevice of the rock. He needed to know, he knew that God was his fortress. He knew that he had been delivered. David knew all these things. He was his buckler. He was all these things. But see, here's the difference in David and us. David lived for him. Now, David messed up a lot of times. So do we. But how many of us have been delivered? And we turn and we go right back into this sin. So I want to ask you this question. What's God mean to you? Who is he to you? Is he truly your rock? Is he your fortress? Have you been delivered? Do you put all your trust in him? Is he your buckler? The horn of your salvation? Is he your high tower? My last question as the musicians begin to come. Is he worthy of your praise? Many of us have been through a lot of things. Many of us have came through a lot of things. And many of us have thanked God for getting us through those. But why so quickly do we turn our back on him? Why so quickly do we forget? If I had one desire, it would be for his church to fall in love with him over again. We said that a lot of times last week. My desire every time I preach is to preach to you like it's the last time that I would ever preach to you, that I would ever preach to anybody. And I want to ask you tonight if you can look at yourself and say, yeah, there was a time when I loved him more. There was a time when I did more for him. There was a time when I knew that he was all these things to me. What did he do in order for you to walk away from him? Does anybody have an answer? Can anybody truthfully stand up and say, well, I was doing all I could to follow him, but God did this to me? No, you can't. We could probably hear some excuses. Well, I went out to that church and oh, such and such. Well, that's such and such. That's people. You need to put your focus on God. People are going to be people. People, let me tell you this, people will hurt your feelings. Wah. Wah. You're not here to serve people. We serve people by loving God. We love people because God died for them. We love them. I love you. But listen, every single time that somebody looks at you sideways, man, listen to me. I'm telling you, do you understand what Jesus did for you? Do you understand what he went through for you? And yet all the time, we just pout. What? Here's my question. I preached this morning on four different people that was at the cross. If you were there that day, verse 36 in Matthew 27 is what I preached on, as they sat and they watched him. If you were there, how would you have responded? I may just go back and preach that message again tonight. How would you respond? If you could go, would you walk to the foot of the cross and say, Jesus, I'm a follower of yours, but such and such hurt my feelings. We're babies. Let me tell you something. We need to get off the milk. I taught you through the book of 1 Corinthians. It took probably a year to do that. But that was their problem. They were carnal Christians who would not get off the milk. He cannot even talk to them about spiritual things. He's like a bunch of babies. We can't even preach Jesus because we're having to figure out who parked in whose parking spot or who sat in whose seat or who got whose blanket or who cried over what. Listen, man, people are dying and going to hell, and we need to focus on what Jesus did. You ought to be out here spreading the gospel. Stop spreading lies. You ought to be here talking about Jesus, not gossiping. You ought to be out here and look at every single person that you come across and know that if they died tonight, that they'd bust hell wide open, but you don't care because we're so wrapped up in our feelings, so wrapped up in ourselves. We're a bunch of babies, and people are going to hell because of our little feelings. As the musicians come, dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you for this day. I thank you for these people. God, I love this church. I love these people. But God, it's not a direct message to them, but it's a direct message to the shape that the church is in today. Not you, Lord, Father. We know that you are perfect. But your body down here is warring against one another, and we pray, God, for conviction that would sweep across this world, God, that we might recognize who you are, what you've done, get ourselves out of the way. God, I pray that you'd move. God, I pray for the one that's in this sanctuary tonight that is selfish. God, let him come to these altars. God, I pray for the one that's just holding anything back, that they'd come to these altars, that they would completely just submit to you tonight. God, I thank you for what you mean to me. God, I know that this has been scattered. I've preached two or three different sermons tonight. But God, I thank you for being my rock, for being my fortress. Lord, to be my deliverer. God, my trust is in you. You are my buckler, the horn of my salvation. You are my high tower. And I thank you, Lord Jesus. I love you and I praise you. It's in Jesus' name. Amen. You come as they say.
375.
I am the clay.
Praise the Lord for what's been done at these altars. Well, it's something in it. Last week we was in revival. We had a guy preach, he's got 4 degrees, and y'all's pastor comes back and sticks his tongue out at you. That's the way things work out around here. Listen to me. I want to tell each and every one of you that I love you. And I have an urgency in my heart that you would see the urgency in how essential it is that we spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. I would pray every man in this place would go home tonight, talk to his wife, talk to his family, pray with your wife, pray with your family, and have a plan. Listen, we've got a plan. If you say, well, I don't know how to spread the gospel, we have a 2x2 ministry here. Go out every day of the week except for Sundays when we're in church. They go door to door. You know, I hear for some reason that door to door doesn't work anymore. Well, last week they went door to door, and I think I had 2 get saved knocking on doors. You say, I don't know how to spread the gospel. You just come go with them. You just come go with them. You say, well, I really don't know what God's called me to do. We preach in every nursing home every week. We preached in the fountains today. You come be a part of that. You say, well, I'm not sure if that's for me. We have a service at the VAC every Wednesday. Have one at Morning Point. That's every week. That's not a once-in-a-month thing. We're going every day at some point throughout the week. And I want you to get involved. I want you to have a desire. Because listen to me. There's people out there that I can't reach that you can. And you can't reach, but I can. That's why we're called to go to preach the gospel to every creature. That's what we're supposed to do. There's always something for you to do here. But I pray tonight that you develop a supernatural urgency and desire to tell somebody about Jesus. I want to tell you that I love you. Be praying for Wednesday night service. Be praying for, the Miller family. Pray for Bobby Dodd. I'll be doing that funeral Tuesday. Also pray for Miss Janie. And everybody else on our prayer request list, I'm going to ask Brother Devin Hayes if he'll dismiss us.
Dear Heavenly Father, come in prayer. I just thank you for this day you've given us. Thank you for just loving us when we don't deserve it. I just pray that you would just give us all a burden to go out and share your love with the lost and dying world, Father, just and really mean it, Father. I just pray that we would just go and reach as many people as we can reach, Father, and just spreading your love and just plant the seeds that may lead to their salvation before it's everlasting too late. Thank you and I love you. Jesus' name I pray. Amen.